Hi everyone, welcome to my channel Music and Science. I'm Stefan. In this video I would like to give you some scientific background information about the question why the sun plays cool music. There are two parts. The second part is this video and there's a first part in another video. Below you can see a video description and on the upper right information cards may sometimes appear. First of all, I would like to show you a beautiful picture of a mountain landscape showing different vegetation at different heights. Have a look at the upper part of the mountains. You can see less vegetation, and in contrast, in the lower parts, you can see more vegetation. This leads to the question, what makes the Earth warmer or colder? If you want to answer this question, we should be aware that our central star, the Sun, plays a crucial factor in this matter. The Sun is nothing else than a star at a certain stage of development. The distance to Earth is about 150 million kilometers. This corresponds to 8 light minutes. In other words, if the Sun would switch off, we would recognize this 8 minutes later. The radius is approximately 7,000 kilometers, which correspond to 109 times of Earth's size. Have a look on the size comparison. On the right hand side you can see the Sun, and on the left side you can see the small Earth. Obviously there's a huge mass of the Sun in comparison to the Earth. It should be understandable that change of the Sun may induce change on the Earth, even though there's a long distance. The Sun is not constantly shining. Every second, tons of hydrogen are converted into helium. Sometimes, huge solar flares are appearing. There's a continuous particle current coming from the Sun, also known as solar wind, which can also impact the Earth concerning its magnetic field. Here you can see at first the Earth, of course, the red contour or the contour traces showing the magnetic tail or the some parts of the magnetic field, and the yellow traces are showing the direction of the solar wind, and from time to time so-called polar lights are visible, especially on the north polar region and also in the south polar region. These specific lights can be visible. It's really impressive if you see the lights on the sky. The Sun is crucial for maintaining life on Earth. The humans regularly observed the Sun and could see interesting details such as black sunspots on the surface, sometimes more or less. In the meantime, we know that there is a connection between these dots and the solar activity. The more sunspots, the more solar radiation could be detected. This phenomenon is not fully elucidated and needs further research. Here, two diagrams are showing the sunspot areas on a time course. Have a look at the lower diagram. Here you can see some accumulations here or here and so on. And if you check the level of this accumulation, have a look, here's a lower level and then the level is increasing and then it's decreasing, again increasing here somehow, and then again decreasing. There's a specific pattern. At the end here, for example, at 2008, there are no sunspots, meaning that there's no solar activity or something like that. What we know for sure is that there is a certain solar cycle of about 11 years, but numerous other solar cycles are also existing. The Sun goes through cyclic phases. And then we come to the question, how is the context between solar activity and climate? There are numerous researchers investigating the involvement of the Sun on the climate, and they found interesting, amazing results. One crucial factor for temperature modulation on the Earth's surface is the cloud formation in the atmosphere. Have a look at the moving of the clouds. If clouds are coming, there's a clear reduction of the temperature on the Earth's surface. As soon as the sun is covered with clouds, the temperature is considerably decreasing. Here it's an example showing a sun setting, and the temperature is decreasing, of course. This is a time-lapse video showing cloud formation, how clouds are rising. Have a look at the lower left side. We know water vapor is rising until a certain condensation level. From transparent water vapor, a fine fog is resulting. Fine water drops are forming. However, the transfer from the gaseous state to the fluid state can only occur if so-called condensation cores are existing. These are very small particles floating in the atmosphere attracting water. This may be salt crystals, dust particles, carbon black, ash particles, and the like. Here I would like to focus on the condensation cores issues. How is the cloud formation at a higher ground? At this point, an interesting experiment from the physics is helpful. A so-called Wilson cloud chamber with an ethanol vapor mixture is shown on the left. Atomic particles will be sent through the chamber, whereby an interesting effect is visible. The particles are ionizing single atoms of the gas, which is visible. Here have a look, smaller particles with a smaller trace, and here larger radiation inducing larger traces. This is the principle of a particle detector. This experiment is helpful to track the traces of particles. If the chamber is free of dust, have a look at the right panel. The ions are affecting as condensation cores. This makes the trace visible because of their charge. So-called core traces are visible. If we transfer this principle to the climate issues, gradation in the atmosphere can cause condensation cores. Initially, the solar wind can change, resulting that more or less particles can reach the Earth. At this point, I would like to explain you the so-called Svensmark effect, named after a famous scientist from Denmark. Have a look here on the left side, you can see a sun without spots. And here again, sun without spots, and correspondingly, there's a weak solar magnetic field. Here you can see the cosmic rays, and if we have weak solar magnetic field, a lot of cosmic rays can reach the Earth. And as you remember from the last slides, radiation can induce these condensation cores. And if you have a lot of condensation cores, there is a increased cloud formation, and therefore the Earth is full of clouds and resulting in a decrease of the temperature. The opposite effect is if you have a sun with a lot of sunspots, indicating that there is a higher solar activity. And here again, the sun with a lot of spots, and then you can see a stronger solar magnetic field. And this stronger magnetic field can suppress somehow the cosmic rays. And if there are less cosmic rays, we have less condensation cores. And accordingly, we have lesser amount of clouds and clear skies, which result in increased Earth temperature. Perhaps you remember one of the last slides showing a grand solar minimum, 2008. Have a look at the left side. You see a sun without sunspots, or a very, very small sunspot. And as you know, a sun without sunspots has a weak solar activity, and this can lead finally to increased cloud formation, as I showed you in the last slide. And indeed, in some countries on the Earth, very cold winters could be observed. For example, in Iran, in Florida, in Australia, and here is an example showing in China, and there are millions of people have been affected. Svensmark et al. Suggested that cosmic rays can cause condensation cores in the atmosphere. Here on the left-hand side, you can see a cosmic ray detector. There's a specific device for detection of such cosmic ray. Here on the right side, you can see a diagram showing the inverse correlation between cosmic rays in blue and solar activity or sunspots in red. This summarizes the connection between cosmic rays, clouds, and climate. I want to expand it in details. Have a look, let's say here. Here we have a low activity of sun or low sunspots and a high radiation. And the high radiation, as you know from Svensmark, induces increased cloud formation because of increased condensation cores. The opposite effect is here. We have a high amount of sunspots, as you remember, a high solar activity. And here we have low cosmic rays, meaning that there are less condensation cores, and this led to a reduced cloud formation. And therefore, we have less clouds on the sky and more sun, and that means an increased temperature. In other words, if we check the minimum here, we should expect low temperatures on Earth. And if we trace these accumulations, we have a specific pattern, as you can see here, which is quite corresponding to the temperature. However, this is only one example which can influence the climate. There are so many other factors which can also influence the climate. Here, a similar diagram is shown, but focusing on sunspot numbers. If we trace back the number of sunspots, there are interesting progressions. Famous astronomers like Kepler or Galilei investigated the sunspot. They used refracting telescopes, which were discovered 1609, and they observed the sun and counted the spots are shown, for example, here. Edward Walter Maunder is an English astronomer and solar observer who found out that there was a certain time period, approximately 1650 until 1715, in the past, with very less sunspots. This Maunder minimum is a small ice age from the Middle Age in Europe with very cold winters. Here, for example, remember the Grand Solar Minimum 2008, which has a low temperature on the Earth. This indicates that a sunspot minimum can cause an ice age if this occurs over many decades. Which famous contemporary was living in this time period? A hint. He has his profession in his hand, and it was Antonio Stradivario. Antonio Stradivario is the master of all violin makers. He has produced more than 1,000 violins in his life and approximately 200 violin celli. We thought he was a genius to produce such master violins. No, it is something else. Here, a painting shows an interesting situation on Little Ice Age. Have a look here, for example, here's a river, and the river is frozen, and a lot of people are walking on the river. You can see interesting situations. Here, for example, somebody's dancing, I don't know, or somebody here is playing hockey. You can see here some different kind of birds here, some birds on the tree and so on. Really interesting to study this painting and the situation of the people here. Very interesting. It was a cold winter. Okay, coming back to Stradivarius. In those days, he handled with wood in his life, which was grown in this little ice age. That means that the grow rings of the trees were considerably closer together compared to trees which are growing today. That means that the sounding board and brilliance of his violins was more compact, which cannot be achieved today. Even though we would have a master violin maker who would be comparable with Stradivarius, he would not be able to rebuild such violins because the specific wood is no longer available. Taken together, if you hear a violin from a violin makers from those days, for example from Stradivarius, Guarneri, Amati and others, you should be aware that they used old wood from Little Ice Age. Here there's again the same time course of the sunspots which I have showed you before. Here there is another interesting time period of other violin makers, for example from Germany or from Neumann Hornsteiner. Here on the left, have a look at the very small distance between the anneal rings, even smaller than 1 millimeter, indicating that is either old wood from a cold period or wood originating from higher grounds where it is colder. Here, I would like to give you an example in which you can even see a small climate change of more than 100 years if you remember the previous video about this topic. A part of the previous diagram is superimposed, as you can see here, so that you can track the curve progression at that time range, including the so-called Dalton minimum. Let us see some details. Have a look here. There are some small, thin anneal rings, and then you can see a slight increase of the distance of the anneal rings. Here again, increasing. Here we have a larger distance, indicating a somehow warmer weather. And here it's going back, thinner rings, indicating it's got a little bit colder. Here again, cold, warming somehow, and here warming, and then again, a little bit decrease of temperature. It's not the same, but roughly we can say that during 100 years, I counted the growing rings, which indeed more than 100 rings, indicating that is more than 100 years of that violin, and you can track the roughly check the development of the temperature. Okay, overall, I hope you can now understand the initial issue why the sun plays cool music. Many thanks for viewing this video.